As I think back on my television watching years, there were two shows that I simply had to watch each week. There were no ifs, ands, or buts about it. One was the NBC Sunday night mystery movie, especially the weeks that Peter Falk as Columbo was featured. The second, and the most important, was Mission Impossible. To miss either one was devastating in my way of thinking. I remember once being out shopping with my family on a Saturday night in 1966. The starting time of my show was inching closer and closer. We weren't going to make it home in time. Ah, shoot. What was it that made the show Mission Impossible such a must-see for this 10-year-old? As I remember it, it was intriguing, spellbinding, and oh yeah, I just love the music. The show is said to have been inspired by the 1964 criminal heist movie, Topkapi, starring Peter Ustinov. The very first title for the show was Briggs Squad. The creator wanted to deploy the everyday Superman into good old Yankee ingenuity. He didn't want any of the regular cast appearing on talk shows during the series run. He thought this would help viewers believe that they were actually real characters. The original Mission Impossible TV series, from September of 66 to March of 73, holds the record for the most episodes of an English language spy show series. There are 171. In second place is The Avengers with 161. The show won 8 Emmys and 3 Golden Globes. When the show was canceled in 1973, it ended the spy series mania of the 60s that had brought about such shows as Man from U.N.C.L.E., Secret Agent, Get Smart, and The Wild Wild West. Ah, let's remember the show's musical theme. According to the television producer Robert Justman, the show's famous theme was not the first one written. Composer Lalo Schifrin had actually written a main theme, but Geller didn't like it and thought it was inappropriate. He found another piece of music that Schifrin had written. He had attached it to a chase scene at the end of the pilot episode. It was that throwaway piece of music that became one of the most recognized show themes in television history. The musical theme was released as a single in 1968. It remained on the Billboard's Hot 100 for 14 weeks. During the show's opening credits, it is the hand of creator Bruce Giller striking the match and lighting the fuse. The Mission Impossible force usually, but not always, received its mission and instructions from a self-destructing reel-to-reel tape recording. On rare occasions, they were obtained from other sources such as records and film projectors. The head agent, either Dan Briggs from season 1 or Jim Phelps, was the one to learn of the mission. On one occasion, though, Agent Cinnamon Carter received the instructions. The tape recorder was actually in rewind mode, not in play mode. Technicians believed that the tape moved too slowly for anyone to believe it was playing. After receiving the team's instructions, the tape would conclude with the now famous warning, "This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds." 12 times, though, they were told to dispose of the tape themselves. It was usually thrown away in an incinerator or tossed in a vat of acid. Now, the tapes didn't actually disintegrate. A special effects technician created the illusion by blowing smoke through a tube into the recorder. The self-destructing tape scenes were shot once a year, all at the same time for the entire upcoming season. The voice of the tapes belongs to Robert Johnson. From an accountant, he became a voiceover artist. He was paid $125 for the pilot episode. Since the pilot sold, he kept coming back and was never identified during the series. Having learned of their mission, Briggs and later Phelps would return to his apartment and choose the appropriate agents from a portfolio. Early on, the main purpose of this selection or rejection of agents was to highlight or feature guest stars as members of a chosen team. The selected agents' pictures were in color. The rejected agents were in black and white. And usually the rejected pictures were of crew members or their wives. Stephen Hill played Dan Briggs. He was the leader at the beginning of the series. He lasted in this role for only one season. He was let go from the series for two reasons. He was an Orthodox Jew, and he had to leave the set by 4 p.m. on Fridays to be home by sundown. He was unable to work on the Sabbath. This often slowed down and even closed down filming production. And at that time in his life, he struggled with an unpleasant demeanor and a troublemaker's mentality. As a result, during season one, his presence in the show was reduced to a minimum. Fortunately, he was able to overcome those issues, and he became a very successful actor. His role as District Attorney Adam Schiff on Law & Order comes to mind. Peter Graves was actually recruited by Desilu Studios to replace Stephen Hill as the lead actor on Mission Impossible in 1967. He portrayed the iconic Jim Phelps, who was the leader of the Mission Impossible force for the next six seasons. He came from an acting family. His older brother was James Arness, or Marshal Matt Dillon, from Gunsmoke. After the revival of the series during the late 1980s, Graves declined to resurrect the role of Jim Phelps once again in the first Mission Impossible film in 1996. The role went to John Voight. He was disappointed that the character was revealed as a traitor, a murderer, and is killed in the end. This decision was not only a disappointment to Graves, but also to several original cast members and fans of the show. Now let's talk about Roland Hand, the most interesting individual associated with Mission Impossible. Has to be the actor Martin Landau, and there's a number of reasons. Now, Martin and his future wife, Barbara Bain, who played Cinnamon Carter, were students at the prestigious Actors Studio in New York City. Among their peers at the studio were James Dean, Steve McQueen, Marilyn Monroe. He had actually become a teacher at the studio and invited a few Hollywood writers to observe the progress of his actors. One of the invited writers was Mission Impossible creator Bruce Geller. He was so captivated by Landau and Bain that he actually wrote the parts of Roland Hand and Cinnamon Carter specifically for them. Because of all the disguises he wore during the show, he became known as the Man of a Million Faces. During the first season, he was always credited as a guest star. He had initially declined the role of Roland Hand because he didn't want anything to interfere with his motion picture career. He and Geller agreed to a guest star status for the first season. For seasons 2 and 3, he signed one-year contracts. Now, there is a fascinating connection, or should I say connections, between the television series Mission Impossible and the television series Star Trek. Actor Gary Lockwood first suggested Leonard Nimoy to Star Trek creator Gene Roddenberry for the role of Spock. Gene liked the idea but was obligated to audition others for the role. Among those that he auditioned were DeForest Kelly and Martin Landau. Now, Kelly turned down the offer to play Spock. He instead got the role of Bones, the chief doctor. Martin Landau also refused in order to play the role of Roland Hand. After the third season of Mission Impossible, both he and his wife, Barbara Bain, left the show. It was Leonard Nimoy who did play Spock who got the role of Paris, the character who replaced Roland Hand during the fourth and fifth seasons. And there's one more connection between the two shows. Nearly every non-lead actor or actress that worked on Star Trek in 1966 also appeared on Mission Impossible. This is probably due to both shows being filmed at Desilu. Though Bruce Geller had written the role of Cinnamon Carter with Barbara Bain in mind, he had to deal with the fact that she was an unknown actress. The network officials kept asking, "Who is she?" She confidently continued through the audition process, which included with a look-see from Lucille Ball. Bain states that when Lucille walked in, she looked at me once and she said, "She looks good to me," and she was in the show. The character of Cinnamon freely accepts, as part of her Mission Impossible Force role, being a distraction as an attractive woman when the mission requires it. Yet she is also highly intelligent and an adaptable member of the team. She's not a token woman member, but an equal to the rest of the team. Greg Morris was cast as the quiet electronics expert Barney Collier. He appeared in 166 of the 171 episodes, which is more than anyone else. At the time of the beginning of the show, producers were under pressure to include black characters in positive roles. Mission Impossible was praised in TV Guide during the latter 60s as an example of the virtuous representation of African Americans with the character of Barney Collier. Peter Lupus portrayed the silent muscle man, Willie Armitage. He usually had very little dialogue. At the time of the show, he was a devoted weightlifter, the holder of world records. He was also a bodybuilder, holding several titles of that. During season 5, the producers decided that his character was expendable. Willie was being seen less and less, and his potential replacement, Doug, portrayed by Sam Elliott, was appearing more and more. The outcry that came from the show's fans resulted in his full-time return and getting a more prominent role. The plot, the ingenuity, and the ultimate outcome of each week were mesmerizing to me. To simply watch the show on television each week was fascinating. Over the years, I have learned a little about what was going on behind the scenes. That has made the show even more appealing to me now. We hope that you've enjoyed learning more about this captivating show. Hurry on to our next video, because this one will self-destruct in 5 seconds. Keep chasing the classics with us, and thank you so much for watching.